What in the world?
CBS Television invites you to join us as mysterious relics representing man in his various civilizations are brought under the scrutiny of a group of world-famous scientists. For each object brought before them, our experts are asked to tell us what in the world it is, where it's from, and when in time it's from. Our host and moderator is the distinguished director of the University Museum of the University of Pennsylvania, Dr. Froelich Rainey. Dr. Rainey.
Good evening, and welcome to What in the World? This week, we have a trio of experts who are all old-timers on this program, and so we've dug up some unusually difficult objects to see if we can really puzzle them. Before we begin, I'd like to have you meet the panel. His usual place is our authority on the peoples and cultures of the Middle East, Dr. Carleton Coon.
Good evening.
And our guest this evening comes to us from Yale University, where he is Sterling Professor of Anthropology. He's a winner of the Viking Medal and an author of textbooks, which I'm sure all the rest of us used while we were in school, Dr. Ralph Linton.
Good evening.
Then our other regular expert is from the University of Pennsylvania. He's an authority on the peoples and cultures of the New World, Dr. Alfred Kidder.
How do you do?
Then our usual announcement about these things. As you know, they are not from exhibition. They come from the museum storerooms or from other sources, and they're being seen by our panel for the very first time this evening. And now I think we're ready for a look at our first puzzler.
Your offstage voice. We bring before our experts first an iron bird, black-throated diver, made by the Tungus people of Limpisk Tundra, Siberia. It's one of a great number of iron objects attached to the dress of a shaman, a priest. This particular bird was collected by an expedition to Siberia in the year 1914 and probably dates to the last century.
Well, Carl, this looks like a piece of modern sculpture. It's not, I can assure you that.
Looks like one of those things they clean their ears out with in Southern Arabia. It isn't.
What's it made out of?
Made out of iron, isn't it, Ralph? Ralph, sure. You take a feel of this. It's iron. Not steel, I don't think.
No, it's iron. Hand forged, of course.
It's not archaeological either, is it, Ralph?
No. Mm-mm.
That's an ethnological specimen.
But it has me completely stumped. I don't know what the...
It's sort of dragonomorphic, isn't it? It's supposed to be shaped like
Might be a bird form. I don't think it's a tool.
Ectomorphic dragon.
I thought at first it might be a saw, but it obviously isn't. I was fooled by those serrations.
Yeah.
This end looks as though it might possibly have some purpose in life.
The opening.
It looks like a modified, Well, it isn't a screwdriver. Couldn't possibly be that, but.
Opening shoe polish cans.
Sure. That's the end, Carl.
What?
Well, this end apparently has just a suggestion of a head, mouth there, but.
Ralph, when you say it looks like a bird form, you're on the right track. Does that help you any?
Wait a minute.
Do they use iron in Siberia where they made those very curious shaman things?
Certainly do, and then those would be a goose. Yakut or Yenisei Osti, is that what you mean, Ted?
Well, I was thinking of those very curious metal forms you get from Siberia, and
yes,
I don't
that's
know.
Right. They were hung on these things were hung on shamans.
Good work, Ted.
They look just like, as Fro says, pieces of very abstract sculpture.
Yes,
collected by Mr. Hall.
Mr. Hall was in Siberia many, many years ago.
With Miss Choplichka.
That would be my guess. Now I don't know Siberia.
How about it, Ralph? You're the professor here. Are you going to back him up?
I pass. I frankly don't know.
No,
I've never seen anything like
that. Right on the nose. That was a...
Iron could come from Africa, but I don't think...
No, this is not
African.
I'm sure this is not African.
You've got it right on the nose. They need those up there now, these shamans. They keep them out of trouble.
What about the age, Ted?
Well, I suppose these things were made in the latter part of the last century. Or perhaps even as recently as the early part of this century. They may still be making them, for all I know.
I think they still are.
Well, thank you, gentlemen. You're right on the head. I shan't delay you any longer. Ted is certainly right with that one, and an almost impossible thing to identify. It comes from the limpist tundra of Siberia, made by the Tungus people, and was used on the shaman's robes, as he indicated. On the map, we'll locate that in northern Siberia, a Tungus area, and these things, this one particularly represents a black-throated diver. It's a bird which they have there, and it since birds are messengers of the gods and free of the earth, the shamans, or medicine men, identify themselves with the birds and sometimes fly as the birds are they represent. This was collected, as Carl pointed out, by H.U. Hall and Miss Schaplitzka, working for the University Museum and Oxford University before the First World War. Well, let's move along to our next piece.
Objects this time come from the Punuk Islands in the Bering Sea between Alaska and Asia. They are two small ivory carvings of winged figures. Their art style is of the Ofik culture, and approximate time of origin would be about the beginning of the Christian era.
These are almost unique pieces. You have to take a good look at these.
Let's pick them up, Ralph. See. They're like.
What are they made out of?
They're made from vertebra, probably. And my bet would be that they're. They come from one of the early polar.
It's a sea mammal, Ralph.
Yeah, it's a sea mammal, and yes, and here your here's your carving. This is from the Bering Strait region, and is it's not Ipiutak. It's probably Bering's. What would you say, Bering Strait?
St. Lawrence Island.
St. Lawrence Island.
Would that be old Bering Sea culture?
It's old Bering. It's old Bering
typical.
Sea. It's not
it isn't typical.
No.
Old Bering Sea.
No, it isn't.
Old Henry Carlin's culture, you mean?
But look at this. Yeah, that
yes.
That sort of incision.
Yeah.
I'll bet that. It's St. Lawrence Island or that general region,
it's
and
Saint
some
Lawrence
of the
Island.
Early Eskimoid
period.
Stuff.
No. Do you know what these things are, Al? Can you imagine what they're used for, or what would you call them if you dug them up?
I would call them problematicals or ceremonials. One of the two.
Ceremonial objects, that old term, huh?
Ceremonial objects.
What about you,
sir? Are these the same things that they have, that they don't, they can't explain that apparently were set up on a staff or a stick, a wing-shaped affairs that they cannot...
I think they're related to
related
them.
To that, perhaps?
Yes.
I can't see any utilitarian purpose for... cutting one of these things.
They were useful to the sea mammal, but...
And then there are a couple of little holes here which look as though they might have had lashings through them. I never seen anything like
these. I've never seen anything exactly like these either, but they do look like the sort of butterfly or whale fluke things that you get from the Bering Strait region.
Well, you know, you're right on the track. All you're missing now is the exact culture and about the age.
Depends on your carbon 14 prison.
That's right.
You believe it's either around 200 BC or else it's around 1000 AD.
Well, I don't think they're old Bering Sea. I mean, if I were to go on of that art style, I think they're later. And I think they might be from the Punuk.
I think they are because of
they're not Punuk.
I'm sure
they weren't.
The color, because I was reading something that I think Fro wrote it that said that when they're brown, they're old.
Well, this
that's
is
right.
That could be a differential
that could just
condition
be
in the ground.
An accident
though,
of the ground. I would, no.
I think they're post-old Bering Sea, Ralph. I really do. You're probably right, but I'd go for
I would
a
say
later
that
period.
I'd say that they were pre-Ippi attack, and I'm pretty sure they're not Panuk, not with this sort of design.
Well, thank you, gentlemen. You certainly got it in the right area, and you got it at the right age and the right people. These objects are almost unique, really. There are three or four have been found on Punuk Island, as you indicated, and two or three recently by the Soviet archaeologists in eastern Siberia. They come from little island of Punuk off St. Lawrence Island in Bering Sea, where Ralph located them. On the map, we'll put them on just off St. Lawrence Island. I think there are only half a dozen of these. They come from the Ofik culture, which I described in 1941.
Not typical Panuk, I said.
That's what you said, and they are pre-Old Bering Sea by our calculations, if our calculations are correct. Mm-hmm. But as I say, it's almost impossible to identify these because there's only these two or three from this site, which we just got from the University of Alaska, and one or two from East Cape Siberia, which the Soviet archaeologists have recently dug up. Well, let's go along to the next piece.
Taken this time to what is now the country of Colombia in South America by this representation of a human head from the lid of a large pottery jar. It was found in a tomb on the east bank of the Magdalena River near Puerto Cervez in Colombia. It can be placed in time between the 12th and 15th centuries.
You have a perfect record so far. I'm not sure you can uphold it this time, Ted. In fact, I doubt it.
Not at all sure we can. we haven't got a very good look at this thing. A pottery head that's been taken off something else.
Perhaps
a vessel, perhaps a pot,
yeah.
Perhaps a figure, perhaps a standing figure, eh?
That puts a new light on things.
Yes, you see, it's not complete in itself.
I thought it was a Roman lamp.
This is a very curious thing. When I first saw it, the eyes suggested an American piece from somewhere in the south of the United States, or even further south of Mexico. But there's something awfully curious about this clay and this curious ring nose.
Yeah. The deep, the very deep incision here. I would
this
beard effect. I would think that it was some of the old Old Aegean or Near Eastern.
What's this bitumen?
This stuff is rather un-American looking.
Yes.
You know, this material,
isn't
really a paint.
That bitumen is petroleum that came from the oil wells up around Kirkuk and around in there, and they used that a lot in the old days. The oil company's interested in the ancient history of bitumen.
Huh. Where are you placing it, Ted?
Well, I'm awfully puzzled, I think when. In spite of the fact that it superficially looks American, I don't believe it is.
You wouldn't get that.
Let's see what we can find.
Whistling boy.
What we can find out there. You think it's... I wonder if it could
might be Anatolian or something of that sort.
The best source of bitumen, if that's what it is, would be somewhere in Mesopotamia, wouldn't it?
Yeah, but they traded it. Kirkuk.
Yes.
It might be Hittite. The Hittites could have got that and traded for those iron knives they were sending down.
A crude bearded figure would fit as Hittite, wouldn't it?
I think it's Hittite.
Who knows really knows Hittite, though? I don't.
I don't.
Unfortunately.
Definitely.
And
you're picking the unknown, are you?
This is a
most... Well, I suppose Rodney knows Hittite, only he's back where the Hittites came from.
Can't appeal to him at this moment, I'm afraid.
No.
Well, how about you're saying a Near East. Are you sure it's near that's the area?
Yep.
I would be sure of that. And probably pretty old. Bronze Age at the latest, and more likely even Neolithic.
Hittite Kingdom about 2500 to 1700 B.C.
You all stand on that?
From Bogas Koy or from Gordian. No, he didn't dig this up at Gordian, but from near there, one of those sites.
How about it, Ted?
Well, I guess I'd go along. I'm pretty sure we're wrong, though.
I think we're wrong.
I think you're wrong, but you don't know what to say.
Talking, you know,
except for the Near East. I would be sure that...
It might be Cyprus.
No. I don't think so, but...
What do you think, Ted?
Well, I have to go along with this, although probably you're going to tell me it comes from some remote tribe in Brazil or something. But I can't see that this, I can't see it as an American thing, and yet it conceivably might be.
I have never seen an American figure that had these whiskers, this whisker effect.
They have bearded faces, but
once
not,
in a while, not this way, with all this way. With this curious stuff on
it's
the outside.
Deep incision, and then smoothed over afterward.
Unless it's from one of these very little known places like Esmeraldas in Ecuador.
That's possible, but yeah, I don't think so. I think it's old world.
Thank you, gentlemen. This is the blow, gentlemen. We should have Gordon Ekholm here on his theories of culture contact. Ted was working around to the end when he said it might be Esmeraldas. That certainly comes close because it's not Middle East. It comes from Colombia in South America, on the coast, right near the Magdalena. And you were almost there, Ted. We'll locate this one on the map in northern South America, on the coast of Colombia near the Magdalena River. It's dated about the 12th to the 15th century American. And certainly a very little-known group of area, very little-known culture from that area. And I felt sure this one would again prove that point of cultural relation between the old and the new world, Ralph.
Right.
Well, while our experts take time out, we have an announcement here which I'm sure will interest everyone. Here we are back to What in the World and look at our next extremely difficult piece.
This armband made of shell is from the island of Nias in Indonesia. It was made by the natives of the island sometime during the late 19th or early 20th century.
Well, this is a sort of lovely translucent thing in pearl white. What do you make of it, Carl?
It's an omelet of alabaster, and I think that we had better do this a little bit by process of elimination, don't you, gentlemen? Mm-hmm. Ted, is that old world? Is that new world?
If it is new world, it is a form with which I am not familiar. And
no, it's I'm sure it's definitely old world.
Okay. Now, if it's old world, can you eliminate Africa other than Egypt?
I think you could eliminate Egypt. I wouldn't be sure that you could eliminate the rest of Africa. There's some of the stuff from Western Sudan that is rather suggestive of this in form. But, on the basis of the material, I might make a bet that it was...
Not Egypt. Egypt is striped. Egypt. Egypt is striped.
Yes. Yeah. It might be Cycladic. You get a very similar type of alabaster...
Well,
marble used there for figures and things.
Ralph, let's do a little more eliminating now. Will you eliminate China?
Yes.
Japan?
Definitely.
Will you eliminate Southeast Asia?
Yes,
and
I
India.
Think so. India, I wouldn't be perfectly sure on. I don't know the Indian stuff well enough.
All right. Now, it's either comes from somewhere between the Aegean and India.
Probably. I wouldn't rule out the African possibility entirely.
Yeah, but you will the Egyptian.
I will the Egyptian, yes.
Take a good look at the material there. I think this may be a clue.
Well, we're getting down then, Carl, really towards Mesopotamia where you get this sort
yes,
of thing,
that's
right?
Possible, yeah. Yes.
And now also
yes.
another place where you get alabaster, if I remember correctly, is in the Sabaean sites
of
Arabia.
Yes,
you certainly do.
That's coming close.
And also you get it over in Ethiopia.
Yes.
And up in Nubia.
Are you sure that's alabaster?
I was wondering whether this was might possibly be pterodactyl, but I don't shell, but I don't think it is. I think it's alabaster.
Look closely, Ralph.
No, it's not porcelain. What?
Look closely at that sea.
Yes. Well, the only thing that suggests pterodactyl is there.
Yes. By gosh,
right
it is.
Is it? If
yes.
It is. Yes. I guess.
Yes. These are growth rings. Sure.
By George, that really looks so much like stone.
Well, then that
is
then,
a tadaktan.
If that's tadaktan, well, then that makes it Melanesian.
Micronesian?
Melanesian.
Yeah.
It's the most stone-like shell. Look at
yeah.
You fellows
but
are really satisfied with
absolutely.
That.
Absolutely. Look at
that's
all
what
the
it
little
is.
There
yes.
And the growth rings.
Thanks for the hint. Yes, it's it would be then.
Tadaktan, gentlemen, is a clam shell.
Giant clam. These things are as big as a baby's bathtub.
Kind of catch your feet and drown you.
Well, that would come then. Solomon's, perhaps.
The right part of the world. How about it, Carl?
Well, I'll ride with Ralph on that.
Ted, how about you?
Come from New Guinea, Ralph?
I don't think it's New Guinea.
In the somewhere up there.
How about the Admiralties?
Admiralties, possible.
Well,
New Britain.
Admiralty, not New Britain. Well, it's possible. New Britain is possible.
Well,
New Caledonia, New Ireland are definitely out.
Well, it's too cold. The water's too cold down around New Caledonia.
Yeah, get this side, and this is the form. Get there.
I'll vote
well,
for the Admiralty.
Okay.
I'd vote for the Solomons, I think.
Ted, will you pick an island?
No, I won't pick an island. It'll be sheer guesswork.
You just say Southeast Asia, will you? Well, thank you, gentlemen. I'm afraid I led you a bit on this clue about the material, but I must admit that when I saw this, I just knew it was alabaster and was hardly able to convince me it was shell. I'm glad you backed me up. On the map, we'll locate this object now from the island of Nias. They're certainly right. It's Southeast Asia, but it's Nias off the west coast of Sumatra. An island occupied by pagan peoples who are famous for their sculpture and various metalwork. Not for this sort of thing, which it certainly looks unusual from Nias. And the form looks like something from the Middle East. There's no question about it. Let's move along to our next piece, which is also rather strange.
The object this time is a fetish figure of a woman made of clay. It's from the little-known upper Xingu River area of Brazil. Though it was made by Indians, there is some doubt as to the specific tribe. It was collected only very recently, and at the time was not more than 10 years old.
This is really a very strange little figure. Ralph, I guess it's your turn to start off, isn't it?
Take it out of there, Ralph. Gee, what's that, a sumo wrestler or a creeping goddess or a bullfighter?
I don't know whether this is quite fair, this piece, as a matter of fact.
Well, sure it isn't, if you admit that.
It is, Ted, doesn't that fall in your, field? Isn't that Amazonian?
Well, it might be, Ralph. It doesn't look like anything I've ever seen.
I've never seen anything like it either.
The
color is a little too much for an Amazonian ethnological piece. Is it fired?
Well, yes, I think it's fired. It feels pretty hard.
The physical type
yes,
is good. Those women with the big stomachs and the high bosoms, that's very Amazonian.
Yeah, and this head is also like this, very much like the Amazonian stuff.
Because I'm eating too much manioc.
Well, this beats me, Ralph. You're right. It's Amazonian. I didn't think you could possibly guess that. What about the tribes? If it's Amazonian, where would you place it?
Who paints themselves like that?
Well, there are so many people that paint themselves in that area. And this
is a montagna.
All over.
The only people that I know that do stuff much like this is the Pirapé.
Good. Thank you very much, gentlemen. This really is a ringer for me. I didn't think I could possibly get that. It is. It comes from that area of the Xingu River in Brazil, as Ralph pointed out. I thought they couldn't possibly get it because it was only made about 10 years ago, collected recently. On the map, we'll locate that on the upper Xingu River in Brazil, the Mato Grosso area. And it's the tribe that Ralph suggested. We're not quite sure of the tribe, but as far as we can figure out, that's it. And when you call your shot that close, it really almost knocks me off the seat. Well, let's move along to our next piece.
We are taken to ancient times by this bronze guanaker in the form of a lion's head. It's from Baysan, Palestine, during the Byzantine era, and its place in time between the 4th and 6th centuries A.D.
Well, here's something that's certainly very different. I think it's your turn this time, Ted.
This is something that I at least am not going to find myself stuck with as an American piece, at least a Native American piece.
Now, we're going to disclaim this one, are you, Ted?
That this might be colonial, because obviously it's of European inspiration. A metal lion with a ring in his mouth, which perhaps might have been used on a door. Don't you suppose, Ralph? It's got the proper number of holes, and that probably comes from a door.
It's a modern casting.
I wouldn't be so sure of that, Ralph. This fellow Parkinson in the museum can clean these things up so that they look as if they made yesterday.
Well, yes, it might be ancient.
Maybe so. Does show just a little what might be patine left there, but I
mean, it couldn't be tremendously ancient, could it?
No.
I mean, we'd have to put it.
The style would put it most. Post-classical.
It's either late Roman or it's something from one of the Latin civilizations, Spanish or Italian, derived from the Roman tradition. It could well be a Spanish door knocker.
Yes, and it might, although it doesn't look quite like colonial, American colonial
this
workmanship.
Isn't quite right.
They're more apt to have a hand, which they got from the Arabs, the hand of Fatma.
Sorry, our time is up, gentlemen. Can you pin it down, Carl?
Italian. 16th century.
Well, that's pretty close, Carl. It's Byzantine, actually. It was dug up at Base Sand. And it comes from the 4th or 6th century. Carl started out by saying it was something post-Roman, and that certainly is it. But it comes from a site at Base Sand excavated by the University Museum some years ago in Palestine. On the map, we'll locate this in Palestine, the site at Base Sand, better known for its Egyptian deposit, as a matter of fact. This is one of the late recent horizons, but of post-Roman date. A thing that we find often in shops, bazaars in the Middle East, Carl. They dig up out there now. Well, I'd like to thank our panel for this evening. It seems to me that they've done a remarkable job here. We've had some almost unique objects, and the only one they really missed is that piece from Colombia, which they placed in the Old World, and that always delights me when they go that handsomely wrong, because there's no question about it in that case. And that was pretty close. I think Ted was working around to it. Now I'd like to thank the panel, Dr. Carleton Coon, and our guest from New Haven, Yale University, Dr. Ralph Linton, and Alfred Kidder. And we hope you've enjoyed this as much as we enjoy bringing it to you. We hope you'll be looking in again next week when it's time for What in the World. Thank you, and good evening.
Sunday night on CBS television, see Toast to the Town, where Ed Sullivan introduces the biggest names in show business. Yes, Toast to the Town is music, song, and drama by stars who'd make any marquee sparkle with pride. Watch for Ed Sullivan and Toast to the Town every week when CBS television brings it to most of these same stations.
This is the CBS Television Network.